I'm going to tell you a story, and it's a love story. While all stories have two sides to them, you're going to hear my side today. And the story starts with the knight in shining armour, my now husband Paul, who rode in to sweep the damsel in distress off her feet. But in truth, I wasn't distressed. I was actually just bored with mundane daily life. And so, as any self-respecting woman does, I went to Africa. I went to South Sudan and Angola. I worked as a nurse and a midwife in a special response emergency team with the UN. We followed the footsteps of war. When the front line moved on, we would fly in with our equipment. We would provide medical and surgical logistical support for the survivors on ground. When the next crisis arose, we would simply follow. I never stayed long enough in one of these places to actually become attached to the little babies that I delivered or to the women that I helped, but I loved this work. It was challenging, exciting, it stretched me to my absolute limits, yet I knew that it wasn't personally sustainable. And love lured me home. My knight in shining armour. Though you would think that the knight in shining armour and the damsel in distress would actually live happily ever after. Yet, now that I had come home, these skills that I developed overseas, they actually started to grate against this first world environment that I'd come back to. I needed a plot change, a new chapter in my story. And so I came up with the brilliant yet naive plan to become foster carers. Because, you see, we weren't ready to start a family, and to be honest, I was just interested in doing something a bit different. I wasn't driven by the need to nurture or to care. It took us 9 months, actually, the actual term of a pregnancy, to become foster carers. And then she arrived. She was tiny, and she was distressed. She was 9 weeks old and she'd never left the hospital because of her life-limiting condition. And she needed emergency foster placement. My planned storyline was that I would use my nursing skills, we'd care for this little child, and she would receive her transplant. I clicked into work mode. Get in, do good, and then get out. My emergency response was triggered and I was back in action. And this response worked in the beginning. But it didn't take long for that sleep deprivation, 24/7 care, the emergency trips at midnight to the hospital, and the ever-ticking time bomb of waiting for a suitable donor. It all wore me down. As her condition worsened and her care needs increased, I actually quit my job. We became socially isolated and completely overstretched. Yet I was determined that I was going to keep this little girl alive because, after all, this story needed a hero. And as we spent more and more time in the hospital, we came to know some of the other families around us that were fighting similar battles for the sake of their child's life. While each family struggled in their own way, the theme was the same. These parents were grappling with the contrasting roles that had come out of necessity. They had now become unwilling medical experts. They were now advocates and carers. They were funding authorities, all the while trying to be providers and nurturers for their siblings. Jobs were lost. Relationships buckled. And seriously, life for all of us just began to fall apart. And yet, in the midst of all this human suffering and in-your-face trauma, I actually felt somehow removed because, you see, this little girl, we were always reminded that she wasn't ours. My story was that I was the foster carer, that this was the emergency placement. She had regular contact with her mother, and we often had to explain that we weren't the biological parents when they were needing medical information. And then there was the quite confronting and very blunt comment from a parent just across the ward when she said, "You have no idea what it's like to worry. She's not even yours." And yet, there were moments where my heart would just beg to differ. because over these months, we had come to know private moments of absolute sheer delight with this little chicken. I knew her quirks. I'd captured her first smile, and for all the mums in the room, I hate to admit it, but one of her first words was Dora. Yeah. Yet, I realised that this presented me with two different storylines. Storyline A, I could stick with the socially acceptable construct that I was a foster carer, her advocate, her ally, her protector, but never her mother in this moment in her life. Or storyline B, the challenge to just drop my defence, to admit that the tables had turned and that the knight in shining armour and his damsel had actually just fallen in love with this little hero that they'd never seen coming. I chose the easy option. I stuck with the emergency response mode. She was 7 months old when we received that miraculous call that there was a suitable donor. And I remember taking this little bundle, tiny, undersized bundle, into the operating theatre, and I lay her on the table. And in that moment, I just started weeping. And this lovely nurse came over to me and she put her arm around me and she said, "Oh, don't worry, Mum, she's going to be okay." And even in that moment, through my tears, I stuck to my story and I said, "Oh, no, I'm not a mum. I'm actually just so relieved for her." The following weeks of her recovery were harrowing, to say the least. Yet with absolute respect and thanks to the hospital staff, we brought this little girl home. And together we shared, over the next 18 months, highs and lows, further surgery, and the ever-present pressure of sticking to my written version of the story. It was the longest emergency response mode of my entire life, but it brought me to a terrible chapter. By now we had realised we could see all her care needs laid out before us. We knew what she needed in the future. And if we were honest with ourselves, we didn't think we had it in us to keep going. By this time, we'd had a new baby. Paul was working and studying full time. And we just couldn't find the extra care and help that we needed. All of the time, I was sitting with this issue that I felt that I could not love her as my own. And through an agonising process, we decided to have our placement reviewed. And a family that had been supporting us through this narrative asked to be her guardian, which is the closest thing to adoption in the current foster care system. This brought me to 3 a.m. in the morning, and I found myself just standing, watching her sleep. And in that dark, quiet moment, my head was not filled with emergency response mode, clinical complications, financial constraints, or even the career that I had surrendered. My whole being was just washed with memories of her. Her smell, her smile, her first step, her birthdays, the way she implicitly trusted me. And in that quiet moment, I realised I'd been her mum. It was a bittersweet moment. This little girl had written her name across my heart like no other human had done before. I had loved her. Yet I was going to lose her. I had loved her and I had missed it. Soon after, the placement changed and she went into loving guardianship of this other family. I had loved her and I'd lost her. I had recognised that I had missed a moment. I had been her mum and I'd missed it. So what do you do when the knight in shining armour and the damsel, they can't save the day? What do you do when your plot takes a twist and you can't find any resolution? To be honest, I just got quiet. I took the sorrow, the absolute disappointment, the guilt, the shame, the regret, and I just buried it deep. I had loved her, but I'd let her down. I let myself down. I had been her mum for a moment, and I'd missed it. I'd written a whole story that couldn't be replaced or erased. Soon after, we continued to care for further children, and slowly, an idea started to grow. We started to wonder what would happen if families like ours could find respite, regular, high-quality care that could meet their in their greatest moments of needs. And what would happen if it was not just here, but it was nationwide and it was across the world? We were felt compelled to do something. And as we started thinking about it and talking more about it, we realised it was actually a children's hospice that we were talking about. And this has now become Hummingbird House. Hummingbird House will be a 24/7 respite and care facility for children with life-limiting conditions that provides respite and end-of-life care, which is actually palliative care for children with a life-limiting condition. When Hummingbird House is built, it is going to be one of only three children's hospices in Australia. Our hospice model is based on the fact that a community group will build this facility and they will contract the expert clinical care service provision from an expert care provider. You see, a place like Hummingbird House internationally is recognised as the community's response to providing support for children with life-limiting illnesses. It's actually a hand-in-hand process where the community, and that means you, you connect your skills, your networks, your finance, and your compassion with the clinical services that are already in place. Because regardless of country or culture, these families, when they find themselves in these situations, when their child is going to die, they don't have time to look for respite and funding opportunities. They need to access opportunities to focus on quality of life. They need to be able to find moments where they can create memories that will last beyond this shortened lifetime. I recognise now that our story was just a drop in the ocean, because it is estimated that over 7 million children worldwide are in need of palliative care. Our vision for Hummingbird House and its collaborative model is that it will be able to be replicated, that it will have a ripple effect across countries and local communities, where a community group will connect with their clinical service and create a space for these children and families of comfort and support when there's not going to be any happy ending to the story. By now, you probably can read between the lines that this little girl that had called me mum, she's actually the hero of my love story. And she is 6 years old. Wherever she is, I really believe that she is actually now the hero of her own story, and she has inspired a service and a facility that goes far beyond my family and this story. Because while I can't show you her face or mention her name, for me, Hummingbird House and our collaborative model actually allows me to say, I love her. You see, I have finally learned the life-changing and hard moral of the story. That you can actually have the power to take the moment of your greatest weakness, that moment that you regret the most, you can turn it into a strength and you can use it to positively disrupt your past failure. You see, the moment that I realised that I had been her mum, it actually crushed me, but it also released me, because I can stand here today and I can say, you know what, I was a passionate parent, but I'm also now, with your help, building the first hummingbird house.